Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to Rock Church Online right now. I'm sitting in my basement, but if this is going live Sunday morning, and Sunday morning that this is going live, it is Easter Sunday. So happy Easter to you. May the Lord richly bless you. Our God is alive. We're celebrating that today and at Rock Church. So you're invited to West Acre Cinema Sundays, 10 a.m. anytime. We have been doing a series right now called Been There. Jesus has been there. Now, God became a man, was born in a manger, lived for 30 years, and then he did ministry for 3 years, and then he is crucified, resurrected from the dead, forever at the hand with the Father, and he's been there. So whatever temptation you've been through, whatever pain that you've been through, whatever you've been through in this life, your God has been there. Jesus has been there, and he loves you, and he knows you. And so we're going to take a look at a Bible verse here. It's Hebrews chapter 5, verse 15, and it says, "This high priest of ours," of course, that is Jesus, "understands our weakness, for he faced all the same testings that we do, except he did not sin." Actually, yet he did not sin. So Jesus came. He experiences everything I experienced. He knew insecurity. He knew anger. He knew all these things, yet he did not sin. So because of this, because he's my high price, because he understands my weakness, because he endured all these things, and because he did not fall victim to sin, so let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and when we find his grace, he will help us when we need it most. I am so grateful for that. I'm so grateful that when I need it most, I got a question for you today. Do you like control? Do you make coffee nervous? Okay. Are you not, maybe you're not controlling, but you're just thoroughly organized, or you have the gift of administration of what everybody else does, if that's you. Now, maybe anybody, if you're in control, go and raise your hand. Okay, I see you. Yeah, that's a little bit silly, isn't it? But I want you to take a minute before we even get started. Try to think for what are you trying to control the most? What are you trying to control the most? It might be your schedule. Maybe your finances that you're kind of trying to control. It might be other people that you're trying to control. We don't like to admit that. But I wish I could control the people around me, but it just doesn't work very good. Do you try to control other people's opinions? When somebody is just so obviously wrong, Are you unable to handle it? And you just want to, you just got to change your mind, man, or else we can't be friends anymore. Maybe trying to control the environment. I want to tell you today, and this is the key. Your need to control shows where you trust God the least. Because the scripture tells us to cast all of our cares on Jesus. The scripture tells us to seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously. And the thing is, when we try to control things that God is the one wanting to control, the more we try to control, the more afraid we are of losing control. And when things go out of whack and you try to get your arms around it and you just can't. And the more we're afraid, the more we try to control and the less we trust God. Did you know that faith and worry can't exist in the same headspace? You cannot be standing in faith for something and being worried at the same time. The scripture says in Hebrews that without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so it is always his plan that you take a step of faith, that you take a step of faith. And so we're going to find Jesus again. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. We talked last week, we talked about something that happened just after this. And you can check that out on our website if you want to, rockchurchfargo.com. But Jesus is in the garden. He already knows that he's going to be betrayed. He actually always knew he was going to be betrayed. But they've had the Last Supper. He has given the bread to Judas and said, hey, the person that eats this is the one that's going to betray me. Peter has said, oh, I'll never betray you, Jesus. I'll never, ever do that. Never, ever, ever. And Jesus says, well, yeah, you little Peter, you get a rooster crows three times. That was 3 weeks ago, by the way. We looked at Peter. When the rooster crows three times, you will have denied you even know me. And so Jesus knows that all of this is going to happen because he's God. And as he's in the garden, I believe I've told you this before, and actually I found some scholars that agree with me, so maybe I didn't come up with this at all on my own idea, but lots of other scholars agree too that at this time, the weight of the world's sin is coming on him. It's my sin being laid on Jesus' shoulders, Hitler's sin being laid on Jesus' shoulders. It was his will that all be saved, and his grace is enough no matter who you are. But it's at this moment, he's in the garden, that the weight of the world is coming upon him. The scripture says he begins to bleed, sweat, drops of blood. He's praying. We find that in verse 36. Then Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane. And he said, sit here a while I go over there to pray. So, hey, you guys, just hang out here for a minute. I'm going to go pray. Just sit here and pray and watch with me. And so he took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. And he told them, my soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Now, the Greek here is using the strongest words it has available to it to tell you just how his soul is crushed by grief. It's to the point of death. Jesus is in an agony. For the first time, he's suffering the agony of being separated from his Father, not for anything he did, because he's the God-man who never sinned, but he's being separated from God because of what I did, because of what you did. And he can't feel the presence of his Father, and he's praying the strongest words possible. My soul is crushed. And then verse 39, he went a little further, and he bowed down with his face to the ground and began praying, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup of suffering be taken away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. I want your will to be done, not mine. So now Jesus is there. He is hurting physically. I mean, he's already feeling the weight of the world on his shoulders. He's feeling heavy. He's hurting emotionally. Not only has he had a tough day already, but he knows that his friends are going to run away. He knows that Judas is going to betray him. He also knows what's going to happen to him. Mentally, he knows what's about to happen. And so he's in that expectation. Did your parent ever have the wisdom to torture you by saying, when I get back to your room, I'm going to give you a spanking? Your parents ever do something like that? They go in your room. When I come in there, you're going to get spanked. Now, I know you millennials don't know what that even is. You know, back in the day, our parents loved us enough to hiss. Okay, that's another. I'm just kidding. And you're waiting. You're waiting. I remember one time I shoved toilet paper down the back. Another time I tried to put a book in there. That didn't work at all. It was pretty obvious that I had a book in there. So my mom didn't even try. But the waiting, oh my gosh, the waiting. So Jesus knows that he's going to suffer the most painful possible death. And mentally, this is coming on him. So he's handling his own fear. His love for you is present in that moment. It's what kept him there, by the way. And so he's in all of this pain. Then he goes out to his disciples, like we talked about last week. Then he returned to disciples, and they fell asleep. And he said to Peter, "Peter, couldn't you watch with me even for 1 hour?" Then Jesus left them a second time. And I put a little note down there. That's how I can do it in my software. Sometimes it takes more than one time. Like I surrender, because you look here, what Jesus is doing here is he's surrendering. If it is possible, take this cup from me. Saying, God, I don't want to do this. I know it's coming. But if there's no other way to redeem mankind, I'm doing it. Not yet. I want your will, because your will is to save humanity. I want that, Dad. I want your will to be done. And so a second time, Jesus comes and says, he prays again. Sometimes the surrendering takes more than one try. It's not a one-time thing. You come to the Lord and you kind of surrender, you kind of try to surrender, and it's not quite there. So then you come back again. God, help me to surrender this. I'm going to give this to you. Not my will, but your will be done. Sometimes it takes more than one try to surrender. So Jesus left them, and a second time he says, "My Father, if this cup cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done." See, Jesus trusted completely. He completely surrendered. He laid it all down. He said, "You know, I know what's coming. The pain, the suffering, the hatred, but God, not my will, but your will be done." Oh, you know, he just laid down all of his rights. He submitted himself to God's will, and he was going to submit himself to the torture and the pain of the cross. So Jesus trusted completely. Us Americans, we don't do that well. We want to take control. You know, we make the change happen. We're going to take and control our destiny. But I got good news for you, because whether you think you have control or not, the reality is you don't control anywhere near as much as you think you do. But you don't always have the power to control. You could even say, I don't ever usually have the power to control, but you always have the power to surrender and just say, God, I trust you. I know you love me. I know you're for me. You're not against me. So let me ask you, would you rather have your will or God's will? Would you rather have what you want, or would you rather have what God wants? Now, if you're a Christian, you've been serving God for a while, of course I want what God wants. Hey, but I absolutely want what God wants, because God wants me healthy and happy, and he wants me prosperous and rich. Well, unfortunately, I tend to think that. I think that God's called me to be happy. I like being happy. I don't like being sad. Healthy, comfortable, trouble-free life. Unfortunately, that's not what Jesus is inviting us to. He's not inviting us to a life of comfort and ease. But rather, what I'm telling you today is that Jesus gave it all to you. We need to give it all right back and say, Jesus, my life is yours. My life is to be a life of sacrifice and surrender. So I have a question for you. I should say this asterisk. Let me go back here again. Happy, healthy, comfortable, trouble-free life. Now, the Bible actually never promises that. But I will tell you that Jesus loves you, and he wants to bless you. He loves you. And he's so much better at living my life than I am, that when I serve him, of course I'm going to be happier, healthier, more comfortable, trouble-free, like, because he is just so good and he is so smart. But he's going to ask me to go through some challenges. and life is tough, and we're gonna walk through that together. But my question for you today is, what are you trying to control that God wants you to surrender? Is there a relationship in your life that you want to control, but God is asking you to surrender? Maybe you're dating somebody, and you know this is not the person that God has for you, and it's time for you to lay that person at Jesus' feet and walk away. Maybe there's a sin in your life that is hurting you. Maybe you're addicted to something, or maybe there's an anger issue, or maybe you got and you're not wanting to lay that thing down. I just want to encourage you that God loves you. You can trust Him. You can trust Him. What are you trying to control that God wants you to surrender? Maybe it's your kids. Maybe your kids are adults now, and you don't have the control over them that you used to have. And God is saying, you know what? You got to let me have them. You can trust me with your kids. How about your marriage? What are you trying to control your spouse and make them something that they're not ready to be yet, or that they're just not getting it yet? What are you trying to control that God wants you to surrender? Do you have sickness in your body today? Maybe you have pain. Is there something that you're trying to control that God wants you just to surrender and say, God, just like Job said, Lord, though you slay me, I will trust you because you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, my God. So three questions I want you to share with you. It's going to give you an idea that you can ask yourself. It's going to give you an idea if you are trying to control something that God wants you to surrender. Okay, number one, does it really matter? Does it really matter? Now, the reason why this is number one, because there's a whole lot of stuff that doesn't matter, okay? It's not that big of a deal. And if I take a step back and look at the scheme of things, and you know what mostly falls into the category of not really mattering is me standing up for my ego or standing up for my rights. If you're married, you know this. My best arguments with my wife has been when I've been standing up for my rights. Some things just don't matter. And my ego is one of them. God hates pride. He hates it when we put ourselves ahead of somebody else. We're supposed to be a servant to the people around us. That's what the scripture tells us. So does it really matter? Is this issue even worth worrying about and controlling and giving all that energy? So number one, does it really matter? Number two, now is it mine to control? Well, the war in Ukraine matters, but I got no ability to fix that. There's nothing I can. I get to vote for president once a year, and that might have something to do. I get to vote for congressman that might have a voice in what's happening in Ukraine. But you know what? There's nothing I can do to Ukraine. So why stress out? Is it mine? It's not my mind to control. Someone comes to me and says, Pastor Scott, I'm doing this thing in my life, and I think to myself in my head, wow, that's kind of stupid. I can't control this person. So, this is what the Bible says about it. But when I try to control somebody, it comes across as like shame. And even if I do it out the right intentions, I'm going to try to control you for your own good. Problem is, it just doesn't work. And so no matter who's in front of me, some things are just not mine to control. I can't control you. I talked about my wife a little bit ago. I can't control her, okay? Years ago when we got married and she was telling me something, I don't remember the context, and I said, hey, you can't control the Cruz. And I get Cruz control, get it? Anyway, my last name is Cruz. Is it mine to control? Lots of times it's not. And when I try to control things that aren't mine to control, well, then I get in trouble for all kinds of reasons. It's very frustrating because I can't make anybody change, right? Now, there are some things I can control. For instance, if I'm behind on my finances, I can do stuff like I have to pay an electric bill. That I can control. Like I can get a part-time job and work a little harder. I can get a side hustle. I can take a bath to get a job, whatever. There's things that I can control, and I should control those things that are my responsibility to control, right? Laziness is never an excuse in God's kingdom. But is it mine to control? If it's not mine to control, finances, then, but is it for God alone to control? Is it for God alone to control? Because I can't control my kid, but God can. I can't control my wife, but God can. I can't control you, even if you're making decisions that are hurting you, in my opinion. I can't control you. You're God's problem. Hopefully I'm preaching truth today. Hopefully I'm opening up the Bible a little bit and saying, hey, this is God's plan for your life because the Bible tells me. But I have no control over you. Now, I'm going to love you either way. At The Rock, at our church, our motto is you can belong before you believe. That means you can be as stupid as you want and come to Rock Church. We're going to love you. We're going to preach the word, right? But that's I just preach God's truth, and I try to help where I can. But when I try to, if I put my hands on you, it always comes across as shame. You shouldn't be doing that. Who do you think you are? Or manipulative, you know, that doesn't work. It has to be a heart change. Now, I can't change my spouse, but God can. If I have a loved one who is sick, I can't heal my loved one, but I know that God can. I can't control the future, but I know the God that can. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. That word trust is actually yada. And yada means to know him, because when you know him, you get to know his character. And when you know him, you can't help but love him, and you're going to trust him, because when you know him, you're going to know how much he loves you. So then this six kind of sheds even more light on it. Seek his will. In other words, when I have some little sin that I don't think is a big deal, I say, no, not his will. If I have that sin, I do not have God's best for me. Seek his will in all you do. So in other words, we don't get to compartmentalize. Well, what happens over there stays over there, you know? When I go to work, I got to be a certain kind of guy. When I do this, you know, I can have, nobody knows about this, and it's not hurting anything. Seek his will in all you do. There's no places where God's light can't reach in your life. But here's the promise. If you trust in the Lord with all of your heart, if you realize that you're dumber than God, do not depend on your understanding, because you're not that smart. Seek his will, and he will show you which path to take. Now, when you've been serving the Lord for a while, and you've been trusting him for a long time, and in your heart, any nook and cranny that you can find, it's like, yes, God, whatever you say, the answer is yes. You know what your prayer life has a lot to do with? Is saying, God, would you please show me which path to take? And so if that's you today, if you're saying, God, I'll do whatever you want, because I feel that way a lot. I'm like, God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And this verse says, he will show you which path to take. Okay, so I'm going to trust in you, God. I'm trust, and that means to know you. God, I'm going to press into you and trust you with all my heart. There's no hidden areas. There's no sins I'm going to wink at. There's nothing that keeps me away from you that is okay in my life. God, I'm going to seek you. I'm going to fast. I'm going to pray. I'm going to get up early and read your word. I'm going to study your word. God, I'm going to do all these things. And then your Bible says, if I do those things, you will show me which path to take. Lord, let my next step be the right step. Oh, that's so powerful. I wish you could get a hold of that. That is so good. So three questions to ask yourself. Does it matter? Does it matter? Number one, does it matter? Number two, is it mine to control? It may not be yours to control, and then you can just go, not mine. Or is it God's alone to control? Now, and remember, it might be yours to control, like your finances. But would you look at my Jesus here? Jesus could have taken control. Anytime he could have taken control. He's in the garden. All the disciples... Well, I got to tell you this first. So Jesus coming down, he chews out the disciples for having fallen asleep. He was irritated and mad at them. Get up, you idiots, you know. Here comes my betrayer. And they go down, and Judas comes, kisses Jesus, and Jesus says, do you betray the Son of Man with a kiss? And then they all fall down. The soldiers fall down. And when they all fall down, you see, read that in the book of John, the disciples run away, including Peter. I forgot to tell you this. before they all fall down, they come up and Peter grabs his sword. He got woken up kind of suddenly. He's like, I fell asleep again. Oh crap. He grabs the sword and chops off the ear of the servant. She's, whoa, Peter, are you gonna stop me? from drinking the cup my Father has given me? No, no, no. He reverts back to his, Peter, I decided to do this. Put your sword down, man. So Jesus, they're looking around for, get his ear, get the guy's ear, man. He takes the ear and says, hey, be healed in my name. He slaps it in on his head, Jesus' name. And then they all run away. And Jesus is taken into custody and they take him. And the guards come and they begin making accusations. And they say some of the accusations were true, but they're spun wrong. They're spun in a way that makes him an enemy of Rome. Because they want to crucify him, but they can't. They don't have the authority to crucify him. Rome's got to crucify him. And so he's there and they're questioning Jesus. And finally the priest says to him, hey, do you say that you are the Messiah, the Christ? And Jesus says, it is as you say, I am. At which point, the group of people, the priests, everybody that was there, went out of their minds. They tear their robes. They scream. They run at him. They begin to beat him and pummel him, and they put a crown of thorns on his head, and they bring him to Pilate, and then they bring him to Herod. We're not going to walk down all, but at one point in time, Jesus is sitting across from Pilate, and Pilate knows that Jesus is innocent. But he's under political pressure because he's already had, you know, the Jewish people have already rebelled a couple of times. He's on his last leg. Like, he's in trouble with Caesar already. And so he said, what am I going to do? And so I'm going to have a riot because the priests, and they had whipped that crowd up into such a frenzy that, and so he's, what am I, and then his wife comes and he says, oh, Pilate, don't have anything to do with this man. I had a dream. And he just tells him about his dream. He's like, man, she's telling, I know that it's wrong. Pilate goes to Jesus and says, hey, Jesus, I know you're innocent. I'm paraphrasing here. So why don't you speak in your own defense? And Jesus says to Pilate, Pilate, you have no authority except which has been given to you by my Father in heaven. You do not have the worst sin. The worst sin are the ones who brought me to you. In other words, Jesus is saying, Pilate, I could snap my fingers and all of the hosts of heaven would be here immediately. I could smoke this whole troop in a moment. So this is my choice. My choice. Why? Because he loved you. You're the thing that kept him on that cross. And so then Pilate, he's scared. He's scared because there's about a riot about to happen. He's scared because of his wife's dream that she had. So he goes out to the crowd and he says, hey, I'm going to release to you one of these guys. All right. You're getting one. Is this tradition to release a prisoner on the Sabbath? How about Barabbas or Jesus? And the priests go out there. They whip the Jesus, Jesus. And he says, well, who then? What should I do with Jesus? And they start screaming, crucify him. Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. And Pilate is taken back, and Barabbas is taken back as well. Did you know? And I checked this out to make sure it was cool, it was true, because it was just too perfect. The name Barabbas means son of a man. He was a nobody, but he was a son of a man. He represented everybody. Get this. Barabbas is guilty, and Jesus is innocent. Barabbas is released as if he was innocent, and Jesus is going to be crucified as if he is guilty. Starting at Garden of Gethsemane, God has weighted Jesus with all of the sin of humanity. All of the sin going all the way back. He scoops through from the beginning of creation all of the sin. He reaches into the future and he scoops in all of the sin. And he brings all that sin from both sides, every sin I ever committed. And he lays them on the shoulders of Jesus. And as he does, the weight comes down on Jesus. And he can no longer hear his Father's voice. And his grit, the Son of God, says to Pilate, I could get out of this mess anytime I wanted to. I could get out of this mess. And Jesus is standing on the stage, and the people that he is dying for, that he loves, he knows every name in the crowd, and they cry out, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. And Barabbas, the son of a man, is set free. and Jesus is taken. He's so weak because they've whipped him. They whipped him 39 times. 39 times they whip him with the cat of nine tails. Little pieces of metal and bone and glass. 9 strands of leather whipped across his back and then pulled. And with every pull, the slashing is taking place. And 39 times 9 slits in my Jesus's back. You could see the muscles. You could see organs. Most people died during that beating. But Jesus doesn't die. He stands. And they take him. And he can't carry his cross, but he walks all the way to Golgotha. And he is nailed onto the cross. And as they drive the nail in his feet and in his wrists, and then they put him up. And as they put him up, his weight slams down on his wrists. And doctors tell us, people smarter than me, that there are nerves. And that would have shot lightning bolts through Jesus' bodies as all those nerves would come down. And then when he came down, he couldn't breathe. Scientists tell us that in that position, that there was no breathing happening. So the only way to breathe, that single nail on his feet, he would push himself up. And all that weight would be on the bones in his feet. And he would gasp for breath. And as he gasped for breath, he couldn't take the pain anymore. He'd go crashing back down again on his hands. And so 9 hours, my Jesus, hung on that cross. 9 hours. He writhed in an agony of up and down, up and down. Jesus could have controlled that day. He could have smoked them all. You don't always have the power to control. Jesus laid that power down willingly. You don't always have the power to control, but you always have the power to surrender. And Jesus asks that of you today. If you refuse to take up your cross, Jesus said this a little while before this, and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. Isn't it amazing? It's already a cross. But if you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. I'm here to tell you today that surrender is not a one-time decision. It's a daily choice. And so you come to God. Sometimes it looks like this. You come to the guy, you might even do it today, and say, Jesus, I give you my life. I don't want to sin ever again. Help me, Jesus. Set me free from this body of sin. Oh, God, help me. Help me. Forgive me. I repent. I don't ever want to be that guy again. And then you give life, Jesus, your life. And then you get up from that place. And then the next day, your buddies come by. And that sin comes around again, and you do it again. So then you come back again, and that's where you're, because we all fail, you know. Then you come back, but coming back is the important part. You cannot out-sin the grace of God. Jesus' love and forgiveness for you goes as far as the east is from the west. There's no end to it. There is no west pole. You can't get west and put a stake in the ground. It goes forever. West never becomes east. It goes and it goes and it goes. So Jesus. Mighty Jesus takes my sin, takes your sin on himself. And so what he's wanting from you today is to lay it all down. So you might sin again. Maybe you've been serving God for a while and you've gotten rid of all the big, ugly sins, right? And now you've just got the cute, harmless ones. Can I tell you something? If you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you're not worthy of being mine. There is no sin that's just okay. Don't wink at your sin, because Jesus is not winking at your sin. My Jesus, the mighty, awesome God. He could have taken control, but he said, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. The guards show up. He does all of this stuff. God, Jesus has a purpose and a plan for your life. And I speak to you, whoever you are right now, that you would know the God of the universe wants I know it. Because when Jesus was hanging on the cross, at no time did he give up on you. At no time did he loves you completely. So I'm going to pray right now. I'm going to give God my life. And I want to encourage you to do the same. And as you do, he's just walk into what he has for you. God, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would come right now and convict my heart, convict the heart of any person that might be listening to this, that God, we would know you. Because I know, Lord, if I know you, I love you. Because you're just so good and you love me so much. How could I not love a God who loved me that much? So Jesus, I thank you. I worship you. I give you my life. And Lord, I pick up my cross. Lord, I sometimes it's heavy to pick up that cross. Sometimes I wonder, Lord, if I would die well, if my life was threatened for you, if they deny Jesus or die. God, I just pray that if that my commitment be such that you would help me through that moment. Because I want to be yours completely. I don't want there to be any ifs, ands, and buts. Lord, all of those sins in my life, I just pray, God, that I become more like you every day, every day, every day, every day. Jesus, let me be like you. Let my motives be like you. Let my pride and ego, Lord, I set that aside and say, Jesus, my life is just one thing. I want to make you smile. Let my life make you smile. And I know when I sin, God, I know it hurts your heart. That's why I don't ever want to do those things again, because I love you too much, Jesus. Have my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, may the Lord richly bless you. Again, that QR code. Again, I guess I didn't tell you this. That QR code right there, I will bring up the mind map that I've been going through. The reason why I said again is because I had to preach this again right now. It's the second time I've done this in front of my camera because the audio was clipping and I had to totally redo it. So I love you enough to do this twice, just so you know. If you want to be involved with Rock Church, you can give to Rock Church using that information. Our God is a mighty, awesome God. And may the Lord richly bless you. And we will hopefully see you soon. God bless.